Devolution.
Twenty years ago, the machinery of Westminster politics frustrated Scottish Home Rule. Nationalists tried to redraw the political map of Scotland.
The SNP was a different sort of political party. It had its roots in the identity of the nation and not in a particular political philosophy.
But instead of delivering a Scottish Assembly, their demands brought down a Westminster government.
It was some of the arguments over devolution that destroyed that government. We destroyed ourselves in the centre.
High ideals lost out to low politics as devolution was held back for a generation and the Thatcher years were ushered in.
Of all the wars, there has never been one which more truly united the entire British nation.
Hamilton has made history for Scotland tonight. Thank you all.
We would propose the creation of an elected Scottish Assembly to sit in Scotland.
We're the Conservative and Unionist Party, and we will always be a Unionist Party.
The settled will of the Scottish people is there for all to see.
We are born and told for English law. Such a part of hope in the nation.
We got five years.
The Labour leader, Harold Wilson, returned to Downing Street after the 1974 general election. But his government was short of a majority. It was likely to fall unless he cut a deal with another party. The obvious place to turn to was the seven Scottish Nationalist MPs. They had arrived at Westminster after a major electoral breakthrough.
I remember coming to Westminster the first time. I came with some reluctance. I regarded myself as going to an English parliament, not a British parliament, but an English parliament. I took it that we were there to do a job which was, if you like, behind enemy lines. And it was our duty to try and represent and to give voice to this feeling of the people of Scotland.
Douglas Henderson, an uncompromising figure on the right of the party, was one of the Nationalist members who now held the balance of power in Parliament. The SNP's election performance had surpassed all expectations. The party's only setback was the loss of its MP for Glasgow Govan, the flamboyant Margo MacDonald. She now had to exercise what influence she could from outside Westminster.
I always tried to promote the idea that they were not as other parliamentarians. Their job was to get Scotland out of there, and that they had to have the attitude of mind, which was not to align themselves with the other parties in Westminster. They were a group of people in Westminster who had a specific job to do, and that was to disentangle Scotland.
The Right Honourable Harold Wilson, the Prime Minister of Great Britain.
Until the February election, the Labour leader had shown little interest in Scottish Home Rule. But now Wilson realised a change of policy might gain him Nationalist support.
We must make sure that the Scottish identity is enhanced, the character and values, Scottish values, not least Scottish socialist values, of your communities and people are preserved and allowed to develop.
Having fear of losing seats made a lot of members of the cabinet sort of eventually come round to the need for a Scottish Parliament. Harold, of course, was a consummate political tactician, and he would have the feeling that you don't stand up against a strong tide of national opinion.
The Labour Party was becoming perturbed about the progress being made by the SNP at that time. Certainly Harold Wilson was. I think that was one of the sources from which the party's devolution policy came. Not wasn't entirely that, but that certainly was there. We make no bones about that. This is what politics is about.
For those like Wilson, caught up in the relentless machinery of government, politics was largely a game of tactics. The offer of a Scottish Assembly was a practical expedient, intended to safeguard Labour's hold on power. Now assured of Scottish support, the Prime Minister felt it safe to call another election.
There now follows a party political broadcast on behalf of the Scottish National Party.
Scotland's oil is now worth a minimum of £150,000,000. What are we Scots going to get from it without self-government?
When oil was first struck off the Aberdeen coast, the SNP was quick to spot its potential. The riches that oil promised demolished the central anti-nationalist argument. It had been claimed Scotland was simply too poor to go it alone. But now that argument collapsed. By the early 70s, oil became the party's core campaigning issue.
The slogan, "It's Scotland's oil, caught light." And it coincided with people not being all that keen really on the Labour Party either. So the SNP benefited. A, it had something positive to sell, and B, the alternatives were not particularly attractive. So that was the period during which the SNP became, I would say, much more grown up politically. And it politicised pretty fast.
It was quite clear from what was happening on the ground that people were in the mood to go forward. And there was a feeling of confidence and buoyance and optimism about all the things that were going on in Scotland, the oil developments and so on. And suddenly this thing bubbled up.
1974's second election campaign saw the nationalists on a roll. Far from checking their advance, Labour's promise to grant some form of limited devolution had nearly encouraged it. People!
The nationalists as individual people were nice enough people, but they didn't appear to have succeeded in any way in capturing the high ground.
Self-government for Scotland means self-respect for Scotland.
We are waiting for results from Scotland now to see whether the Scottish Nationalists can continue their advance, and no doubt they are looking rather hungrily at two or three Tory-held seats.
In fact, on election night, four more Tory seats fell to the Nationalists, who now had 30% of the Scottish vote, and with it, 11 MPs.
And here's Mr. Wilson in a very affable mood indeed. Well wishers, shaking hands.
The Labour leader scraped an overall majority of three seats. But the pressure for devolution was as intense as ever. Home rule was not just a deal with the SNP, it was a manifesto pledge. Wilson asked his trusted deputy to translate the promises into legislation.
I think that when he sent for me and asked me to do devolution, he did it for a number of reasons. First of all, I think he felt it shouldn't be done by the Scottish office. Better to do it by somebody outside to do it.
Hedgehog was well distanced from the entrenched positions of individual departments, so that he was able to take a fairly broad view, uninhibited by a sort of narrow departmental interest. And he was one of the cabinet members who, I think, actually believed in the merits of devolution, not just as a piece of political expediency, but actually as a good thing in its own right.
Wilson's decision to sideline the Scottish office from the devolution debate angered Willie Ross, Labour's authoritarian Scottish secretary. Ross felt it wrong to appease nationalism and had a visceral hatred of the SNP.
If there is anything that's been seen over these past few weeks, it's the irrelevance of that shoddy party that to my mind disgraces the name of Scotland with its cheapness of slogans for dividing this nation.
He was anti-devolution. There is no ifs or buts about that, and I hope I'm not doing Willie and his memory a disservice. Willie fought a rearguard action to minimise the powers of any proposed Scottish Assembly, and it was not easy to work with him.
This is where the sniping and snarking of the SNP are so totally irrelevant to the future of this country, to the future of Scotland.
Ross's hostility was shared by other cabinet ministers, but it was the Whitehall machine itself that posed the greatest threat to devolution. The idea of Scottish Home Rule was anathema to many at the heart of government.
Civil servants were imbued, as everybody was in those days, with the belief that what matters was centralised authority. And you had to have a centralised authority, otherwise you hadn't got a nation.
It was one problem after another, going through every aspect of government, you know, from dog licences up to taxation, everything. You devolve it to Scotland or not.
Taking away the moments that make us a dull.
There were civil servants, I think, in various Whitehall departments who resisted devolving some powers to Edinburgh, which ministers in Whitehall thought they ought to continue to exercise.
Kicking around on a piece of ground in your hometown. Waiting for someone or something to show you the way.
Well, we ran into trouble on the functions. When they began, were looked at in detail, of course, you suddenly found that there were things you needed to retain at Westminster.
Once the government unveiled its proposal in November 75, it was clear the planned assembly had been stripped of most of its powers. Under devolution, Scotland would have little control over the economic issues the nationalists cherished. For the SNP, it was a sellout.
We were very disappointed with the government's white paper when it came out. They made all sorts of promises which were pretty specious when you actually examined them. There was not going to be real power for this mini-parliament, and the real issues, control of finance, control of oil, control of all these things, was going to stay with London.
Hanging on in quiet desperation is the English way.
Nationalists were not alone in feeling dismay. One of the few pro-devolution Labour MPs, Jim Sillars, was so shocked by the weakness of the proposed assembly, he chose to go it alone and resign. An act of principle which perplexed Wilson's chief whip, Bob Mellish.
When I left the Labour Party, it was the process of leaving. I had my final interview with Bob Mellish. And Bob said to me, what are you doing this to yourself for? You know, I've got a safe Labour seat. So, you know, what are you doing this to yourself for? And he actually said, you must have known we never intended to have an assembly. It was just to get votes. So I was dead right. You know, I didn't trust Wilson, and I was found to be correct.
Dismayed by Wilson's backtracking, Jim Sillars tried to set up a rival Scottish Labour Party, demanding a parliament with real teeth.
We are laying claim to be the natural inheritors of the principles, the philosophy, and above all, the motivation of the Kirhardies, Maxtons, and Tom Johnsons, who once made Scottish movement a shining example of what socialism should be.
If Jim Sillars had stayed with the Labour Party, I think not only would he have had a future in the Labour Party, but he would have brought pressure to bear on producing the right sort of solution for Scotland. But he gave up any influence he might have enjoyed in the belief he could get more influence by doing something
fancy. And in politics, the fancy footwork hardly ever comes off.
Within 4 months of Sillars' departure, the Prime Minister himself had unexpectedly resigned. But by then, for Sillars, the damage had been done.
I just felt that there was intellectual sleaze creeping all over the Labour Party north and south of the border during Wilson's period. And I think he corrupted the intellectual integrity and quality, whatever was there, of the Labour Party. I think that's his legacy.
Mania has come back to Britain, and most of the screaming has been for a British group, the Bay City Rollers.
By the mid-70s, the country had a lot more to worry about than Scottish devolution.
As soon as the Bay City Rollers appeared, fans tried to rush the stage.
I think we hit the spirit of the times. Remember, it was the 70s, dear. Balloon pants and things.
With Wilson gone, the Labour Party hastily arranged a new leadership contest. Jim Callaghan, Wilson's foreign secretary, had never backed devolution. But during the leadership contest, he secured the support of his Scottish colleagues by putting his doubts to one side.
I think that that was the point at which Jim Callaghan swapped sides. Now, I don't blame him, because he did the arithmetic. The arithmetic was that far more Scots MPs said that they were in favour of devolution. Whether they were or not is another matter. Jim did the arithmetic. Now, once you've done that in a leadership election, it's jolly difficult to divest oneself of what one is committed to.
Some of us who'd been in favour of these arguments all the time had a better chance to persuade the leadership of the Labour Party to come in that direction too. I don't think Jim Callaghan, I'm not saying it against him personally or anything like that, I don't think he was a great enthusiast for the idea right at the beginning, but he went along with it. He wanted to see it through, and he understood that the survival of the government might depend on it, as it turned out that it did.
The Conservatives, under their new leader, were still nominally committed to devolution. But after a triumphant first visit to Scotland, Margaret Thatcher had other intentions.
Mrs. Thatcher had a major problem because the party, the Scottish Tory party, was totally split on devolution. She was worried the party was disunited, but she couldn't go along with devolution because she thought, as I thought, that it was a load of absolute nonsense.
Isn't it a fact, Mr. Taylor, that you'd really like to see your party ditching its commitment to devolution altogether?
No, I think you'll find that every one of us believes in decentralisation and devolution.
Despite such denials, the Conservatives had already resolved to scotch Labour's plans. Taylor, now the party's Scottish spokesman, held his Glasgow seat because the anti-Tory vote was split between Nationalists and Labour. He now feared his leader's enthusiastic unionism might cost him his seat.
Mrs. Thatcher probably said, Teddy, I want you to destroy the SNP. And I said, but Margaret, I hope you appreciate if I destroy the SNP, I'm out, I'm away, because I rely on an SNP vote. She said, Teddy, I'm sure you'll be okay in Cathcart, but that's what the object is. I want you to destroy the SNP. It's a funny kind of instruction to give someone though, when they're meant to be in charge of Scottish affairs, but she felt it was so important.
Thank you.
Unaware of Taylor's instructions, the Nationalists remained upbeat. They were the fastest growing political party in Europe. But as their membership increased, so too did signs of ideological and tactical division.
The SNP, you see, in these years was still something of a movement. The SNP's always had two tendencies, between those who made common cause with others and some of the purists who believed that it must be done in a pure, direct, independence, nothing less, route. And from that, tensions rose.
As delegates gathered for their 1976 party conference, conflicts over strategy came to the surface. The Labour government looked vulnerable, and some nationalists thought they could force a general election.
I believe that if I am interpreting the mood of this conference correctly, you wish your parliamentary party to do everything within its power to bring about that election at the earliest possible moment.
I really put it to the party, what would they rather have? Would they rather go along with this government, or did they want a general election? And would they support us if we were instrumental in bringing the government down and creating a general election?
So I'm just going to finish now, and I'm going to ask you to raise your voices. I'm going to ask you to raise them so loud that you'll let Callaghan, Thatcher and the lot hear you. Do you want an election? Yes! Will you win?
Yes! There was a great ovation, of course, which was not one of these phony ones that you get at party conferences. This was a real thing. In history, there are people who have been capable of making these kind of speeches. Lloyd George was one. General de Gaulle was capable of making speeches of that caliber. There are decisive moments when you have to speak out and speak up.
It was one of the cheapest political speeches that I can remember anybody ever giving. And it was also inept, entirely self-indulgent, because the long-range camera shot of Douglas at that podium looked terribly reminiscent of all that stuff he had seen from Nuremberg. I was watching it and I was thinking, I know what they're going to say. This is the fascisti bit. This is the mindless whipping up of an audience who are responding and shouting back and so on. But I also recognised that that was probably it. And it did actually mark the start of the descent.
Just as further gains had seemed possible, the nationalist advance faltered. Members could all agree on the final aim of independence, but they were at loggerheads over the tactic of supporting a British government offering the half measure of devolution. When the bill for a Scottish Assembly finally reached the chamber at the end of 76, the government knew they were in trouble. Not only did opposition parties have reservations, many of Labour's own side wanted to stop the legislation.
It is exceedingly difficult, maybe mission impossible, to set up a subordinate parliament in part, though only part, of a unitary state, a kingdom which, above all, you wish to keep united. Because once a parliament is formed, when they are dependent on money from another parliament, the tensions are inevitable.
The parliamentary progress was a nightmare, or to be more accurate, the absence of parliamentary progress was a nightmare. And I suppose after a couple of weeks, we all began to feel that it might do for us.
Heading the Commons' guerrilla warfare was Tam Dalyell, the Etonian Scottish Labour MP. He exasperated his own front bench with persistent delaying interventions.
One of the qualities that an MP must have is not to be bothered about being a bore. On such an occasion, I know I was an endless, endless bore.
Well, he was quite right. I mean, he did bore all of us. And that self-possession of the old Etonians means that whereas those of us who are less well-educated sometimes think halfway through speeches in the House of Commons, the sooner I sit down and remove myself from the sight of these glazed eyes, the better. Such considerations, humanitarian or otherwise, never bothered Tam.
You know, it's the old question, as in football, if there is difficulty of going for the ball, go for the man. If there is difficulty in winning the argument, chastise those who are seeming to lead the argument being put.
I actually believe that Tam would prefer to be burnt in the marketplace in Edinburgh than to see Scottish devolution pass into British law.
After a deluge of interventions from Dalyell, the bill had sunk into a quagmire of amendments. And the tenacious backbencher was gaining dozens of converts during the all-night Westminster sittings. Whilst things were difficult for Labour, they were utterly draining for the Nationalist MPs. Almost 3 years of long-distance commuting had taken their toll, and this latest parliamentary marathon only added to their burden.
It was a time of exhaustion and tiredness, and it was night after night after night after night. It was a very, very heavy time, with, of course, determined opposition being put up by the Tories, backed by the 40 or so Labour MPs who in reality were making common cause with them.
Once back in Scotland, the weary SNP members were expected to attend meetings of the National Executive, the party's original leadership body. Some within the party hierarchy had missed out on election. Their isolation from MPs was becoming a source of strain.
We shouldn't have allowed all the high offices to go to non-elected members. There was tension. We were getting all the limelight. They thought our life was glamorous. It was anything but to stay in that prison till 3 a.m. But people thought it was glamorous. And there was a certain degree of jealousy. A lot of people who had nearly won but hadn't won probably felt frustrated. You know.
They were at great pains to emphasise that they had got elected and that somehow we hadn't got elected. And so that made us somehow less politically astute or something like that, which of course was a lot of nonsense.
These growing tensions demanded dynamic and resolute leadership. But the Nationalist MPs were led by the unassuming member for the Western Isles, Donald Stewart.
Donny Stewart was a totally delightful Hebridean gentleman, the essence of decency. Donald once said, jokingly, "You know, it was a lot easier when I was here by myself and was chief whip, and when every time I went through the lobby by myself, decision was done."
Donny was not a great political leader or anything like it. And yet, some folk who should have known better than the SNP almost canonised him. He didn't bring out the best in that parliamentary group.
By the start of 1977, the Labour government seemed certain to fall within weeks. With their majority long since gone, the whips were turning Westminster's corridors into a field hospital.
We're having a time where we were trying to keep the government alive, carrying people in on stretchers, ambulances coming in every night, nodding them through. I remember one night, I think it was Leslie Spriggs, the MP for St. Helens, had a heart attack, and they brought him in on a ambulance, on a pacemaker, and it was a tie in the house. And Joe Harper went down with Straddling Thomas, the Tory whip, and he said, "Yeah, well, this is our majority, this guy, Leslie Spriggs." So the Tory whip says, "How do you know he's alive, you know?" And he turned the knob on the machine and the green light went boop, 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 boop. And we were surviving on votes like that.
The devolution bill looked doomed. The delaying tactics of Dalyell and others meant only a handful among hundreds of amendments had come to a vote, and no real progress had been made. At this point, the government made a desperate attempt to salvage things by trying to set a time limit or guillotine on discussion. The future of the bill now depended on a majority of MPs accepting a deadline for debate.
Having a guillotine on a constitutional bill like this was regarded as something which you should only do with the greatest reluctance. But in the end, it was perfectly plain to the government by February 77 that if they didn't have a timetable motion, a guillotine motion, then they weren't going to get the bill through in that session at all. And so they just had to try it. And I think the government was surprised as the days went by at the number of people who were clearly going to vote against that guillotine.
As Labour backbenchers threatened to defeat the guillotine motion, attention focused on the government whips. The grease in the party system Their job was to ensure the smooth running of the government machine.
The favourite line that you heard in the Whip's office is devolution. They speak of little else than the drummer monkey. I mean, it was not seen by the Whip's office as being something that the country at large was very much interested in. But the Labour Whip's office ran very much like a sergeant's mess in the British Army. That although we thought some of the orders coming from upstairs were crazy, it was our job to implement them, so implement them we did.
The government's leading whip was the blunt Yorkshireman, Walter Harrison. Harrison had been a corporal in the army and did not shy from barrack room persuasion.
Walter Harrison was the deputy whip, and I actually saw him once get hold of Eric Heffer by the shirt and hold him over the River Thames and say, "You're going in there, you bastard, if you don't get in that place and vote." You know, he was a hard nut, Walter, smashing bloke.
One of our colleagues went absent, and it was discovered that he was on holiday in Crete. "Aye," said Walter, "when the bugger comes back, he'll be in concrete." That was the sort of character that he was, and you didn't mess with Walter.
But even Harrison's persuasive powers were unable to deter enough of Labour's anti-devolution rebels.
In spite of all the efforts of the government whips, the government was defeated tonight by 312 votes to 283, a margin against the government of 29 votes.
I can recall to this day the vote being announced and my sense of deep, deep depression. I think I can still see myself sitting with my head in my hands, not in tears, but deeply depressed. I sat in the chamber for ages, trying to come to terms with a result of a vote that I never believed would have happened. That was when the Labour government's fate of that era was decided.
The unexpected decision of the Liberals to vote against the government had helped destroy the guillotine. The leader of their party in Scotland, Russell Johnson, was unrepentant.
Russell Johnston for the Liberal Party, in his winding-up speech, Mr. John Smith accused your party of wriggling out of your very long commitment to the principle of devolution by not backing the government on their guillotine today. What do you say to that?
I say that that's not true.
Shocking. Shocking betrayal by the Liberals. Unbelievable, almost, because they were meant for the Home Rule Party. So they're just a unionist party like the others. In a way worse, because they professed to be a Home Rule Party. So it was really a set of constant betrayals. And a lot of them would like to forget that little chapter.
I can't really remember what the reason was. I can't remember exactly now, I must confess. But I would need to refresh my memory. I'm sure I wrote notes about it at the time.
We will never forget, and we'll never trust them. I mean, they are a party of Britain. And I don't know where they're going in Scotland, because they don't seem to really want what they say they want. I think they like it down there.
Again, Westminster gambits had shattered Scottish national aspirations. As the House went through the motions of debating a bill that was now fated to run out of time, Enoch Powell, one of devolution's most eloquent critics, judged the mood to perfection.
Enoch, I remember saying that there's an odd atmosphere in the House tonight. I couldn't place it. And then I realised that it's like a house in which there has been a recent bereavement, and the body of the loved one is still in the house, and you tiptoe past the door, and you look at the face, and it is so much the same, and yet so very much changed. And he meant that here was this bill which we would continue to discuss as if nothing had happened, but the whole situation had changed, and there was not a cat in hell's chance of that bill now reaching the statute book.
But though legislation for a Scottish Assembly was now sidelined, some felt this might be a blessing in disguise for Callaghan.
He wasn't too bothered, actually, when the devolution bill fell by a guillotine, and he thought, well, we'll play the SNP along and we'll keep going and we'll stay in. The SNP have got to support us. They can't bring us down. They don't want the Tories. They won't get it at all.
Football, or Scottish football in particular, brings out a lot of strength in people, a lot of strength in Scottish people, and a lot of aggression.
There's an overlap, Martin Buchan. Good running by Buchan, read it well. There's Gary Douglas in there, over the goal!
England had failed to qualify for the World Cup, and Scotland had qualified. And in some strange way, the success of Scottish football was associated with Scottish nationalism.
When Scotland won a place in the 78 World Cup finals, it seemed the pride the country had lost at Westminster might be regained on the football field. Prior to departure, the Scotland manager gathered his team at Hampden for premature celebrations.
Ollie McLeod's got a lot to answer for. I mean, he persuaded the Scottish people that Scotland was going to win the World Cup. And of course that was never on.
As Scotland prepared for Argentina, Callaghan kept the nationalists on side by trying again to advance legislation for an Edinburgh-based assembly. But to placate critics within his own party, he agreed to test public support for any constitutional change with a referendum.
People weren't justifying the devolution proposals on merit. What they were doing was saying, well, look, the Scots so overwhelmingly demand this that we have to give it to them. And then they ignored the impossibility of the thing lasting. So it was fairly natural to say, well, right, if you're not basing your case on merits, but only on an irresistible, overwhelming demand in Scotland, the natural thing is to say, right, let's test it. And then to demand something more than a simple majority.
Cunningham proposed an amendment to the bill requiring 40% of all Scots eligible to vote to support the idea of the Assembly before it could be established.
The Cunningham Amendment was a killer, but it was also irresistible. It had the wonderful dual qualities of being totally destructive and intentionally totally destructive, but at the same time intellectually impossible to argue with. I think it's probably the best amendment of its sort I've ever seen, and we knew once it laid it that we were in trouble.
Robert Burns said that whiskey and freedom gang together, and the whiskey flows freely enough in air and all over Scotland as the immortal memory is celebrated with the traditional Burns supper.
On Burns Night in 1978, the government faced several crucial votes on the new Scotland Bill, including Cunningham's amendment to set the 40% hurdle. But the January festivities were causing problems for the SNP whip.
I never had any great difficulty in getting people to turn up for our votes, virtually in all of the time. But it wasn't easy because quite a few of them had been very busy with the haggis and the whiskey as well. But I did manage to get most of the troops through the vote.
But though Hamish Watt was successful in getting his nationalist MPs into the lobby, the Labour whips were struggling. Their only hope was to obstruct proceedings until parliamentary business finished for the evening.
We were coming up to 11 o'clock. And Walter Harrison, then the Deputy Labour Chief Whip, was encouraging Labour members to stay in the division lobby and not come out and be counted.
If we stayed in there after 11 o'clock, the amendment could not be put to the vote. Now, this was a somewhat untested theory that not all of us were convinced about, but Walter was a very commanding figure, and so a group of us remained in the lobby.
I popped out of the chamber, and you can look through the door into the no lobby, and I could see Walter Harrison wagging his finger at me as if to say, you're not going to win this one. So I rushed back into the chamber.
Walter was finally persuaded to lead us all out, and we appeared somewhat shamefacedly, this ploy having failed, to the laughter of our own colleagues and the derision of our opponents. But that's how desperate it was.
As 11 o'clock began to strike, the government went down to a heavy defeat. Cunningham's amendment was passed. Whilst the government was in the toils at Westminster, the nationalist tide was ebbing in Scotland. When you're lonely and tired inside, in two by-elections, Labour candidates held off the nationalist challenge as the SNP splits widened.
We managed to put up a pretty good front. People didn't realise just how bad it was behind the scenes. We looked as though we were putting up some sort of fight, but the whole thing, oh, it was dreadful. You could feel the support ebbing away. And don't forget to try it on the
Waverley. As the Nationalists' support crumbled, Labour's held steady. By the autumn of 78, some Labour strategists thought they would win a quick election, but Callaghan delayed.
There was I, waiting at the church. All at once, he sent me round a note. Here's the very note. This is what he wrote.
It was the most incredible and stupid decision of the century. Political decision. I'm absolutely certain.
Now let me just make clear that I have promised nobody that I shall be at the altar in October.
He had made the promise to the SNP over 2 or 3 years that that government would deliver the devolution. And if we'd gone in September, October 78, there wasn't a devolution through.
Although heavily amended, the new Scotland Bill finally made it through the Commons. Work began on the Assembly buildings. The final obstacle, the referendum, would take place in March, if Labour was still in office. Callaghan's decision to postpone an election meant his government faced a winter mired in industrial unrest. It was hardly the right backdrop for a referendum campaign.
I can remember the posters with Jim Callaghan's face on them saying, "Say yes," and this was immediately after the winter of discontent. The campaign suffered from the fact that the Labour Party had planned it well in advance. Nobody wanted to say yes to Callaghan on any subject at all. It was a disastrous mistake.
The Labour Party would not soil its hands by working with the SNP. This was a joint campaign.
Of course we should have had a more concerted campaign. There were some people in the Labour Party who wouldn't meet at all with the Scottish Nationalists, and maybe that helped to injure it.
Good afternoon. Now's the day and now's the hour for Scotland and devolution, or it should be. Scotland is still saying yes, but only just. And as we forecast on the News at 10 last night, it's saying yes well below the target of 40%.
At first, falling at the 40% hurdle seemed to destroy Scottish hopes for an assembly. But the Nationalists knew the government couldn't give up devolution altogether. There might still be ways around George Cunningham's blocking tactics.
The Prime Minister on his Sussex farm is saying nothing. Mrs. Thatcher and the Scottish Nationalists have declared themselves ready to bring the government down. If they do try to get devolution, said Mrs. Thatcher. If they don't try to get devolution, say the Nationalists.
Would you bring down the government if it didn't deliver on this?
Since there is a majority in the form in which issues are normally decided in the UK, the government will have to deliver, and the government cannot depend on us for any kind of life insurance unless they deliver quickly.
They have one last chance, and if they don't take that last chance, then we must vote against them. We must do everything we can to get everybody in the House of Commons to vote against them. And if that means, Mr. Chairman, going in for the fancy Dan parliamentary tricks that they appear to be looking forward to, then we would do it.
At a party meeting in Dundee, straight after the referendum, the Nationalists agreed to back Donald Stewart's ultimatum. They chose to give the government 1 month in which to take devolution forward.
We went to Callaghan, we said, look, Prime Minister, put the bill to the House. That's all we ask. And if we lose, we lose. But if you don't, you've 30 days.
But 1 week before the Nationalist ultimatum expired, the Prime Minister was still stalling.
The government is firmly committed to devolution. But before the House makes such an important decision, there should be a short intermediate stay.
Donald Stewart!
And is it not a reality that he is prepared to treat the Scottish people with contempt rather than face an early election?
Now confident of Nationalist support, the Conservatives delivered the coup de grace.
Devolution and the way it's been handled are the occasion for us to put down a no-confidence motion. Enough is enough.
On the night of the vote, angry Nationalist MPs resolved to stick to their word. But for one, the decision was agonising. Hamish Watt had left the Tories to join the SNP. He could not bear the prospect of now helping bring down the government.
My constituency were determined that I would not vote down the government. And I was so glad of their backing. But it didn't prevail against the greater weight of opinion in the party. So as late as the night of the vote, I was still in touch with my constituency, and they were pleading with me not to go through that lobby to vote down the government. But in the end, my nerve failed me, and I finally went through the lobbies with them. After I'd done it, I felt terribly badly because it was totally against my conscience. I tried to get into the other lobby to cancel my vote, but just at that moment, the doors closed, and I didn't get in.
The ayes to the right, 311. The noes to the left, 310.
Watt's vote had proved decisive.
I never felt so alone as I did that night. Despite the fact that there were 600 and odd MPs around me, I was completely on my own. I had done something against my better sense, my better judgment, and it aggravated me. Had I been able to go through that other lobby and cancel the vote, I think I could have lived with myself. But no, I burst out in tears when I realised the gravity of what I had done. I had lost a parliament.
I've read in history during the 19th century, English governments fell over the Irish issue. This is actually the first time since the Union that an English government fell as a result of the Scottish issue. So it's quite a historic situation in Scotland. I have absolutely no qualms about having done it, and I would do it again, irrespective of the consequences.
The Nationalists entered the coming election defiant, but a disenchanted public cast them back into the political wilderness.
My regret always was that the SNP didn't get it together in the way it might. Well, it was a lack of professionalism. It was politics, though. It was politics. It was hatreds and old enmities and real differences of opinion. And equals.
They were serving in a parliament that they didn't wish to be part of, and so it was rather awkward for them. And I don't think that they ever got to grips with how to play the game, how to get what you want in the Westminster Parliament.
But in burying the SNP, the Labour government dug its own political grave. The Nationalist parting gesture was to prove catastrophic for both parties.
I don't think they knew what the hell they were doing.
the government's failed to provide what we hope they provide, therefore we're going to kick somebody, and the government is the obvious people to kick. They didn't know they were shooting themselves in the head. They just thought they were shooting in some direction or other, and they hit the wrong target.
But faith and power to minus not.
It was to be a generation before the struggle for Scottish Home Rule forced its way back to the political arena.
We are born and souls for English
glory. And the programme concludes next Saturday at 8.